All right, let's get the party started again. Next up, we have Andrew Godwin. He's going to talk to us about scaling down and running large sites locally. Andrew is a member of the Django core team. He's a senior engineer at Eventbrite and is the original author of the Django Migrations Framework and South, which was there before. He, as I said, works at Eventbrite, where he focuses on the architectural stuff. And yeah, let's see what he has for us. Give him an applause.
Thank you, Marcus. So yes, as just discussed, I am a Django core developer and, very relevant to this talk, a senior engineer at Eventbrite. And what this talk is really about how Eventbrite's internal developer tools have evolved over my 4 years there. So let's go back in history a bit to 2013, when I joined Eventbrite in, I think it was roughly in August, about this time. So I came into Eventbrite as a slightly more naive, slightly more junior developer, and I thought, oh, there's no way that their code base can be worse than Lanyard's. It's a bit crufty, and we've got a few hacks in there. Boy, was I wrong. But the key thing to think about is how it was organized. So at the time, Eventbrite was pretty much one big Django monolith with, I think, about 20 or 30 Django apps in it. And all of this ran on one big Vagrant VM. As a developer, you would sit down, install the Vagrant virtual machine. It would take an hour or two to rebuild itself and install all the packages and all the dependencies. There's about 200 requirements lines in there, I think. And eventually, you get a working machine. Now, if you have any sense of how developing works, you may realize there's a little bit of a problem on the horizon here, which is that things tend to grow. So let's flash forward to today. In 2017, we still have that monolith, but we have 40 individual services that also talk to it. What we're doing is we're taking the big monolith and slowly carving out pieces of it into separate services running over a microservices framework, which is, of course, very fancy and modern and all those things. But what the practicality of this is that those are individual things that run by themselves. And each of the individual services has their own data store. And what this leads to is roughly 150 different moving components. MySQLs, Cassandras, Python containers, JavaScript renderers, all of that stuff. And what this means is we have a much more complex system. In particular, we have 150 Docker containers. If you've ever tried to deal with Docker with about 10 containers, you know that's already a hard ask, let alone having 150 of them. A crucial thing is, though, we've kept it to 1 to 2 hours rebuild time, which is still worse than I'd like to. But given the growth we've seen in those 4 years, we've managed to keep it down, keep it sane. So how do we do that? And more importantly, how do we do it with this? There's a lot of site. There's so much site, in fact, that it takes about 24 gigabytes of RAM to run all of Eventbrite on one person's laptop. Now, if you are familiar with the Apple product line, Apple will only sell you a maximum of 16 gigabytes of RAM. And so unless we can download more RAM from the internet, we have a very bad chance of having to run the whole site at once. And this results in this huge, big ball of code and RAM usage, and the monolith is still in there as well. And we have to work out what to do with it. Now, when you think about developing with Docker, many people first turn to Docker Compose. They're like, oh, well, of course, we have this tool that Docker wrote. Some of my friends, in fact, are people who wrote Docker Compose from a company I used to work at. And it's a very good tool for taking a few different Docker containers, plugging them together, and understanding how they work. Unfortunately, if you present it with 150, it starts to have a small panic attack and goes away into a little corner. And so we had to learn to overcome not only the size restrictions, but other problems we had as well with Docker Compose. And this is why we have what we call Bay. Bay is Eventbrite's internal replacement for Docker Compose. It is a tool for running development environments based on Docker with not only lots of images, but lots of disparate images that relate in different ways and managing that really complex web of dependencies. We'll see that in a bit. But first of all, what is Bay at essence? So first of all, it's Python 3. It is one of the big things I went into the project doing was like, no, we have to have some Python 3 code at some point, everyone. We may as well start with the separate DevTools stuff that's not part of the rest of the site. So it was our first Python 3 project. It's now not the only one, thankfully, but it was leading the way internally for us at that. It runs against the Docker API, so it does still talk to Docker. It's like Docker Compose, it's a layer on top of Docker, and I'll describe some of the issues that brings with it, but it's much better than writing your own from scratch container system. I've done that in the past. Come and ask me how later if you want to, preferably over a drink. It's very difficult. And also, we want to be portable outside of Eventbrite. It's no good developing a tool like this and saying, and it's just for internal use. Like, not only is it not a great way to design software, to have it so internal and probably it just fits 2017 Eventbrite rather than 2020 Eventbrite, but also try and share it with everyone else has the same kind of problems. Now, if you saw my talk yesterday, you may have seen this slide where I very wonderfully said, don't reinvent the wheel. It's excellent advice and I'm ignoring it entirely. There are reasons in this case to reinvent the wheel. As I said, Docker Compose is very well known, it's very widely used, it's well documented, but there are some key things it doesn't do. And these are the three key things I sort of want to talk about in this talk as to why we have an alternative to Docker Compose. The first one, the biggest one, which you've seen from that RAM figure earlier, is running subsets of the site. Now, we can't run a whole copy of Eventbrite on any one laptop, and we don't tend to do the thing where you run on a virtual machine in the cloud. Some companies do that. They give each developer a huge virtual machine. You SSH into it, do your development there. We don't do that. Part of that is because we have some remote developers in places like Argentina, where the bandwidth is very bad. And part of it is just a cultural thing from all the years, like working on planes and places with bad internet in general. The other thing we have is developer code mounting. This is where you can work on your code live on the Docker sort of Docker container set, and it understands how to do that. And I'll come to that much more later in this talk. And the last bit is image building and pulling. Now, Docker does image building perfectly well. That's what it's designed for. But there are some key things in there, like SSH keys and authorization, that aren't part of the main Docker suite. So I'll come to those as well. But let's start with that subset stuff, with containers and links. So I just told you that there are 150 of them. If I was allowed to, I would show you the full graph of all 150. Unfortunately, the names and the layout is proprietary and confidential, so I have a very contrived example here for you instead. If it was this simple, I'd be a happy man. So here you can see this tree of five different services with some kind of theoretical site where we have a core Django monolith with its own MySQL database. We have a separate payment service, which we do have internally at Eventbrite, and payments has its own MySQL database as well for auditing. It's an append-only database. And then a Redis that we use for caching and other things like that. So if you just have these five containers, you need to not only have them, but start them in the right order. When you use Docker, you have to tell each container what the address of the container it's depending on is. So there's an implicit ordering in this stuff. In particular, you need to start with the edge node, the leaf node in a tree system, and work your way up. So we start Redis first, and we start the auditing MySQL, and then we can feed those addresses into the containers above them. And this way, we can start them in order and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and have our five containers started and knowing where everybody else is. There are some problems here. For example, if I restart the Redis container, I have to restart everything that depends on it because its address can change. Docker containers happily change addresses and ports whenever you reboot them or restart them. But there is an optimization here to start with because I've done a very simple numbering here. I've literally just gone, we're going to do a tree search from the bottom up and do what's called a topographical ordering, and just order them in linear and do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is, in fact, how Bay's predecessor called Tug used to work. As a bit of history, what happened was we started moving to Docker in about 2014. At that time, we made a tool called Tug, which did a lot of the stuff you see here in Bay, but it was a bit worse and a bit sort of less developed. And last year, me and Ashwini Origati rewrote Tug into what is now Bay, and formalize all the concepts you see here. One of the key things is we discovered that we could change this particular inefficiency and do it in parallel. We can take everything that has no dependencies, start them all at once in parallel, then move on to the next thing that has satisfied dependencies, which is payments, and start that, and then move on to the last thing, which is the Django monolith, and start that last. And so what Bay now does is it understands this parallel stuff. It can go through a tree of dependencies and start the containers in parallel at once and save you potentially minutes of startup time. Imagine there are 20 or 30 things in this tree. Each container takes 10 or 20 seconds to boot up. And the time you save going from this linear thing to the parallel thing is quite substantial for a developer. But let's talk about the subsections. I said at the beginning, you can't run the whole thing. Well, let's imagine in this case what we do. I, for example, don't want to work on the payment system. I'm just doing like front end on the main site, just doing some design changes, some nice CMS stuff maybe. So I just want to run this subsection. And what Bay does is Bay understands that you can say, hey, I want Django without the payments dependency, and it works out, it can remove the payments auditing dependency as well, and just gives you this subsection. And moreover, it lets you label these sections with names. So we call them profiles. So different teams inside the company can say, oh, well, we have the payment schema, we have the front end, we have the ordering profile. And it defines a sort of subset of that tree you can run at once. And what Bay does is Bay adapts to the new tree and changes the ordering to make things match what you've just done. Now, this is all well and good. It lets you go through some containers and boot them in order, but there's a little bit of an issue with Docker. And the issue is how Docker boots things. Now, without going into a very long, detailed explanation of how Linux kernel containerization namespacing works, which is a whole other talk, the key thing to understand is that when you make a Docker container, it makes sort of its own little OS by itself with its own little startup process. And from the outside, all you can do is say start, and you can try and connect to things on it. You can't really sort of see what it's doing in particular. And the other problem is that, well, Docker containers are meant to only run one thing. In a Docker file, you can say, hey, when you boot the container, run this command. And you get a choice to supply only one command at a time. Now, I subscribe to the idea that they should run one logical thing, that is, one overall component or service, and thus there might be three or four processes serving that one. For example, there could be a service that's serving web requests and a scheduled cron job inside that that's cleaning up as well. And so this means we have the problem not only of knowing when we've finished booting, that is when the website's ready to go, but also we want to run more than one thing at once. So this is where we bring out the big guns. And me being me, I wrote my own init function in Python. So if you're not familiar, init is the process in a Linux machine that is the first thing to run. It boots everything else. It cleans up child PIDs and zombies and other things in POSIX you never want to know about. Because I am lazy, I wrote it in Python rather than in C or Rust or something. But the key thing is what this does is it gives us a few of those extra features. It gives us things like knowing when the boot's finished, because what this can do is, because it's running the programs, it can run the startup scripts, then run the programs. And when the programs are finished, it writes to a file on the file system in the container. And then what Bay can do is Bay can look at the file system and we can peek at what's happening and work out what the status is. The other thing it does is parallel startup. It takes the command line you pass it and actually runs them in parallel. And in particular, what it does is it does a Docker thing where if any of the things you're running die, the whole container dies. If you've seen some of my other talks, I'm a big believer in explicit failure. This is one of those things. We don't want to have a container keep running if some part of it dies. It's a whole single thing. It's an atomic unit. So anything that dies, whole container goes away. And this isn't really provided by Docker's init script. There's a couple of other things, like the cleaning up zombies. When I wrote this in 2014, this wasn't present in Docker. Docker have since, I think just this year, added the fact that their init script does more of the cleanup stuff. So it has improved a bit, but there's still a bit of a need for this. But there are more things than this. And some of our containers don't have a custom init script, which is, you know, why would you want to not have a custom init script? That sounds lovely. And so we need other ways of working out what's going on, like how are these things working? What are they doing? And so there's more things called waits. And what waits are, they're a way of saying, these are the conditions by which the container is running. Like when you see these reactions, we know it's good. They're sort of health checks in a way. And so things like TCP waits. So for Redis, for example, we say, OK, when you can open a TCP connection to the Redis port 6379, then it's finished booting. Then you can find the next thing in the chain and start doing it. Things like HTTP, like our WSGI server, can be a bit more clever. We can say, well, when you get a valid HTTP response 200, then you can keep going. And it's important because, in our case, the socket will open, and then it will spend over a minute bootstrapping itself with 300 dependencies and all the libraries and around 400 megabytes of RAM of just Python code before it can actually serve you a request. We have a monolith, remember, it's huge. And so you have to not only open the socket, but get a response back and then go, aha, now it's ready to start giving you requests. And finally, for our services are Some of them are HTTP based. Some of them are based on Redis. So there's some more custom checks around that stuff. But all of these are like, how do I know when this is finished booting? And these feed into that startup process and let you know, OK, this is how I am going to understand what's going and what's going to keep happening. But that's just running containers. And running them is half the problem. The other half of them is rebuilding the containers. And this is kind of the more difficult problem in a way. We can run containers reasonably easily and restart them, and it's all fine. They start pretty quickly. But rebuilding is slow. We have so much code and so many dependencies, not just Python dependencies, but Debian packages and custom unzips. And at one point, a Java 8 tarball was downloaded. And in Argentina, that takes about an hour to download sometimes. It gets really slow. And so it takes a long, long time to do this stuff. And we got it down. That big monolith rebuilds in only 10 minutes in the best case. And it's kind of a lie. We'll come to the lie in a second. But as I said at the beginning, like the full rebuild of all the different components is about an hour or two in San Francisco. In Argentina, in Mendoza, it's around 8 or 9 hours in the worst case, which you can see if you come in for the morning as a developer and you're trying to work on some software and you need to rebuild, that's your whole day gone. You can't do anything. And so we're trying to solve some of these problems. But the first problem here is the actual rebuilding itself. And it's one of the key things we solved in the beginning of Bay. So the way Docker works usually is you make a Docker image, and the image is static. So when you build it, it makes you a file system. You take a big image of that and plonk it down. Whenever you run a container, you take the static file system, and you just use that. You can't modify or persist changes. What this means normally is when you're changing the code, say you edited a template or a Python file or a view in Django, and you want to have that change take effect, you'd have to rebuild the Docker image and include the new file in the file system and then restart the image to make it have effect. Now, this is fine if you're a small site. It's like a 2-second rebuild. We have 10 minutes, which is still quite fast in the relative scale. But if you are having to refresh test template changes, this is painful. It's basically impossible to test stuff. And so what we have called dev modes. This is where you can take different parts of the site and live mount them from your Mac or your Linux machine through into the Docker containers. And the idea is that Bay understands the layout of your site. It knows that when you want to mount the monolith, where it comes from in your working directory and where it goes to in the container. One of the examples here is it knows about Python packages. So it says, when we want to mount our current library, which is our internal library for safe currency handling, it knows that it has to go from my home directory into the Python 2.7 site packages place. And all you do as a user is type bay mount current. You don't have to know about the internals of Python or library paths, but it manages this stuff for you. And this means our developers can say, oh, I'm working on the current library, so I'm going to mount that, and I can just write stuff, and it will just load and refresh in the browser for me. And this kind of ends up with this situation where we have sort of a dual situation. The things we can dev mount, the code and templates, we don't have to rebuild for those. Because they are live mounted through into our images, they just take effect. You can edit templates, hit refresh in the browser, and see the changes. But there's other stuff that does need different stuff. Our OS packages and our dependencies, for example, those have issues because those are part of the Docker build process. Like we have apt-get install PyTZ in there, for example. And those you can't really live mount nearly as well. Like you want Docker's ability to manage packages and do that stuff. And so we have this split where anything above the line, if it changes, you have to rebuild it. And you might think, well, you know, how bad can that be? Because, you know, like surely, Andrew, you're only ever changing the code and the templates very often. So because we have a lot of services, and many of those services run as libraries against the main core, they are themselves dependencies. And so every small change to a service in Eventbrite generally results in a dependency change to core. What this means is that repository changes dependencies every hour or two on average, which means that the build caching don't work so great. You have to rebuild pretty much every time you pull from that Git repo, which is not great. And so we sat down, we're like, well, how can we solve this? We need to fix this problem. And you know, bear in mind that if we had Vagrant or similar, this would still be an issue with Vagrant. And in particular, if we think back to the alternate history where we had, oh, we still have the big vagrant virtual machine with all the code in it. Well, first of all, it wouldn't fit in RAM, but we'll ignore that. Lots of swap, maybe. But the second thing is you have to rebuild it all at once. You can't rebuild a portion. With Docker, we can say, I just want to rebuild the payment system. You can't say in Vagrant, I want to just rebuild this section. It has to go through and do all the new packages and do that stuff for you. And so with Docker, we have a little bit of an out, which is that Docker images are portable. Once you've built them, you get sort of this big blob of file system, and you can move it around. You can ship it to other servers. You can deploy it in production in the typical case. We don't run Docker in production, just in development, for reference. But what we can do is we can ship them around. And so what we tried to aim at was, well, what if you just build these images once in one place and then pull them down? Sort of, you know, we have here a machine that just builds the payment systems and the Redis stuff and all the different stuff. And then developers in Argentina, in Nashville, in San Francisco, in Seattle, we have many different people around the world, can all just pull down those images and save all the time of not only the bandwidth, but it's very chatty. If you're building a, say, a Python package or an apt package, you have lots of bounces to and from a server. It's very latency intensive. And the problem with Argentina is that their latency is very high, but their throughput's reasonably okay. And so we give them one big file download. That's much better than having lots of tiny requests going backwards and forwards. And this is where we sort of, where we are now. It's a little bit of a difficult area. We are still trying to work out all the difficulties because it turns out when you start working on a system to build dependencies, you end up plunging yourself into, we need to have a release management system. It's sort of the awful side effect of like, oh, you've just gone down the rabbit hole that leads to, we have to fix the entire data model of the site. But we are getting there. And so I want to talk at the end here for the last 7 minutes or so about what's next, what our changes are for Bay. I've given you a brief idea of how it works. Again, it's hard to describe all of it, but here are some perhaps more interesting ideas of what the future holds for it and other things that we can't do with Docker Compose and other Docker tools. The first one is that automated image building. So this is not just having a server that builds the images. We have the problem of our sort of master branches on Git aren't necessarily always stable. You can't rely on the latest checkout to always work. And not only that, we have, you know, 150 engineers. You can't synchronize across who's working on what and say, well, we want the stable version of this code. Oh, it's commit A3C4F, and that doesn't work. And so our quest is to have a system that has not only automatic building, but tagging of stable versions. So if you're just working on, say, one system, like the order flow, you can just ask, I want the stable versions of payments, the stable versions of front end. I don't want the latest dev copies. I don't care about the latest and greatest stuff. I just want the stable versions. Right now, you can't get that. Right now at Eventbrite, you always have basically the latest master release of everything, which occasionally means developers sort of pull from the repos until it all works and just don't pull for 3 days because they've got to the right place. And it's a stable configuration. And then when they finish the project, they're like, oh no, I need to pull a repository. And so they have like an hour of like pulling things and trying to make it all work again. So I'm trying to get around that problem. The next big thing, and this is really a big thing, is trying to run some of that stuff remotely. Now, I said at the top that we run everything on one machine. This is mostly historical. And I would love to give our developers the opportunity to run things on other machines than their laptop. This is a particular problem for our native engineers for mobile, because if you develop Android, you'll be familiar with the idea that RAM is a precious resource with the Android Studio IDE. And having an emulator and Android Studio running is already like half of your RAM gone, and then Slack's another quarter of your RAM gone. And then you're left with about 6 gigabytes if you're lucky to run everything else in. And so there are certain teams in the company working on like our hardware, like RFID scanners or mobile, who don't need most of the site on their machine. They just need like one or two things they're playing around with. So we want to run different subsets remotely. And we can build on what we had before. Like Bay understands those dependencies between systems. It knows that if you have a payments container, that needs to talk to the MySQL for payments. And so we can teach Bay, hey, this payments container is remote, which means everything it depends on is also remote. And building on this, try and have the idea of running whole stacks of this stuff remotely, like taking all of the different containers and saying, I want to run a whole copy of development Eventbrite on some remote system. And this is a thing we have internally where, say I'm making a whole new hack day prototype of like, I've changed the order flow to have funny balloons on it. I don't know, something crazy like that. But I want to show it to my colleagues. I want to put it up somewhere and show them. Right now, we have a static set of QA servers, numbered 1 through 5, imaginatively. And you can reserve them on a wiki. And you can reserve one, and then you go into the server, and you can upload stuff to it and use it. But on things like hack days, there's 5 is not enough for 150 people. And so finding a system where we can use our dev tools as also a sort of pre-staging like QA and demo area will be really useful as well. We want to share that work and not have to have our operations team who run production also have to run all of our city developer QA stuff as well. And a big part of this is trying not to reinvent the wheel. If you are familiar with what I've been saying, I've been describing Kubernetes at some point, or Docker Swarm or Nomad. And all of these tools have those slight problems that they don't quite match what we need. Like I said earlier, like, oh, there's the things about mounting and dependency management. And this is still true of these other tools. Like Kubernetes is very capable, but it takes like a team of 5 people to configure it each time. And it's not going to be happy with you just carving sections off and changing the config without a whole other layer on top of Kubernetes. And so what we're trying to do is look into how we can wrap Bay around not only Docker, but around things like Nomad as well, and like try and keep the abstraction there and the understanding of this sort of higher level idea of how things interact, but also try and use some of that existing technology. And as I said yesterday and today, try not to reinvent, sometimes it's necessary, but try not to reinvent the wheel. If you are curious about Bay, it is up in a repository on GitHub. It is open source. It is very poorly documented, I warn you now, but the code is quite nice, I think. Thank me and mostly Ashwini for that. So you can go there and see it. There's a small README. My intention is to get some proper model and process docs in there. There's some start for some docs, but it's not very good. But if you're curious at all, go and have a read. It has some interesting ideas about how to do CLI library stuff, and there's a plugin system. There's sort of Django signals equivalents in there. So there's a lot of code to read if you're curious. And thank you very much.
Thanks, Andrew. As a token of our appreciation, coffee mug.
Thank you very much. Yes.
We are pretty much out of time. There's a next. Oh, wait a minute. No, the next session up here is going to be Raphael Merckx on mocking virtual reality for Python tests. There's a 10-minute break now.